Psalms 3. And here we go. Lord, how are they increased that trouble me? Many are they that rise up against me. Many there be which say of my soul, there is no help for him in God. Selah. But thou, O Lord, art a shield for me, my glory and the lifter up of mine head. I cried unto the Lord with my voice, and he heard me out of his holy hill. Selah. There's some, I don't think the scholars have ever decided what Selah means, but someone said it means stop and think about that. And I think that comes just about as close for anything as the meaning of Selah. It's kind of like stop and think about that. Meditate on that fact. This is the time that David's son Absalom had rebelled against him. Very serious rebellion. Got a lot of Israelites on his side. David had to flee for his life. Now the Psalms, when you read them, they're full of war. And I'm reading them to you because we can see the enemies moving in the land, and we need the strength of the Psalms. We need to know them, sing them. Stan and Larry need to make up songs about them. David was a man of war. He's a man of war. Solomon wasn't, and he crashed at the end. Solomon did. David made mistakes, but he kept on fighting, and he died in the presence of the Lord. He was a warrior. He made Solomon's empire possible. And I think some of us can identify with these words. O Lord, how many are my foes? That's what Annette is saying. What in the world is happening? How many are my foes? How many know that once you relax, you get another reason to pray? Did you ever notice that? Don't give up. Don't give up. You say, well, I just fought 69 battles. The 70th is on the way. Don't be amazed that it's one thing after another after another. Stay with it. Stay with it. God is doing something in your life. You'll have all of eternity to rest. I mean, you're going to live forever. That's what Jesus said. He lives and believes in me, shall never die. You're going to live forever. It's just a short time. So don't quit. It's one thing after another. You just get out of this mess, and you're into another. That's normal for the Christian warrior. I don't know about those that are not serving God, but for those that are serving God, this is normal. Normal. Oh, Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? We're being challenged. And David was challenged because he was a man of righteousness. We're being challenged because we're preaching righteousness. Sad to say, a lot of in Christianity today is preaching all kinds of things, but not righteousness. Audrey was pointing out to me that in Romans 6, the exhortation isn't even to serve the Lord, it's to serve righteousness. I never thought about that. Serve righteousness. Romans 6, serve righteousness. Serve right, like it's your Lord. It's important. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. But see, this world is not righteous. The people in it are not righteous. The devils are not righteous. And when you begin to try to do God's will, you're going to have enemies. They're going to rise up against you. This isn't going to be a pushover. People, this is a battle. This is a war. And I'll tell you, when you find out, is the moment you make up your mind and you say, I've had enough of this fiddling around. I'm going to serve God. That's when your battles start. As long as you kind of float around, you'll have this problem and that problem and all. But once you say, I'm going to set my course, I'm going to go in a direction, I'm going to pray, I'm going to read my Bible, I'm going to serve God, I'm going to be a real Christian. Once you do that, there's a lot of enemies that say, we don't like this. We're going to fight you. We're going to make your life miserable. And if you want to inherit the promises of God, you've got to be a winner. You've got to conquer. If you get discouraged, come and get prayer, get help. God will make it possible for you. I know there's times when it seems it's impossible, and that's what it says here in the second verse. Many are saying of me, God will not deliver him. Now, why would they say that? You have any idea why people would say that? You would think they would be saying to David, hang in there, man. You're going to make it. No. And you're going to find out that once you start to really serve God, don't be surprised if people say, yeah, that's the big righteous one and everything. Look at him. We're doing fine, but they're having problems. I hope you have problems. David was standing for something. David stood for something. There was a lot of wicked people in David's day, right in his own household. And David stood for something. He stood for righteousness. And people don't like that. And then these things began to come on David. And they said, see there, God isn't going to help him. God is going to save him. Where is this God you talk about there? He isn't going to help him. So don't be surprised when people do that. Don't be surprised. When people and things happen to you and you started off and people know you have a testimony that you're going to serve God and it makes them uncomfortable and then God begins to deal with you and then they stand back and say, see, it's nothing to it. God isn't going to help him. So be prepared for that. You got to go through in spite of people, not be angry with them. Just ignore them. Do what God says. Doesn't matter what they think. You made up your mind to serve the Lord. What does it matter what anybody else thinks? Huh? You're serving the Lord for their opinion? You gotta serve God for his opinion. That's what Paul said. I try to please the Lord. Selah, think about that. Meditate on that. Many will say there's no help for him in God. Many people are going to say that. God is not going to help you. There's no help for you in God. God isn't going to help you. Selah, meditate on that. Give that some thought. Let it percolate in your brain. People are going to say that. What is your response going to be? You care what they say? You do. You won't get very far with God if you spend much time thinking about people. But you, they can say what they want to, but you are a shield around me, O Lord. You know, to us, that's an anachronism. We don't fight with shields anymore. But up until the time of the invention of gunpowder and going way back in history, people had shields. Sometimes they were wooden. Sometimes they were metal. Sometimes they were small. Some of the Roman shields covered their whole body. The Roman legion would get together and they'd form a Roman square, and they'd put those shields down. Man, there was nothing but a wall around them of metal. You couldn't get at archers, couldn't get at them. Sometimes they anointed their shields with oil. Why do you think they did that?
It glanced off. The guy hit you with the spirit. The oil would slip and it would glance off. Buckler was a little shield. You probably see the Norsemen had little shields, little
round shields. The Romans had big things that were around 5 feet tall. Shields. In people's mind meant war and they meant protection. So we have to kind of think back in history and picture it. The Lord is my shield. These things are coming against me. But if I'm trusting in him, God is a shield. We sing this psalm, don't we? Many are they which rise up. Thou, O Lord, art a shield. God is our shield. Man, nobody can get past that. No devil in hell can get past that thing. That shield. We keep it up. Shield of faith. You are a shield around me, O Lord. Now, that's a big one. That's a big shield. It covers your on the front and on the side. It's a big one. They had big shields like that in some of the customs. You are a shield around me, O Lord. You bestow glory on me. You give me glory. God gives me glory. Here I'm down here. I'm weak. I feel sick. I'm depressed. I'm tired. Sometimes I think that there's something unusual about this area, Southern California, that makes you tired. Everybody's tired. Tired. Man, I'm tired. What's wrong? You run to the doctor. I'm tired. Everybody's tired. I think it's a spiritual oppression. It's part of it. Maybe not the whole thing, but I think it's part of it. But God sends us His glory when we pray, when we look to Him, right in the middle of all this tiredness. You lift up my head. I'm down, Lord. I'm down. I can't get my head up. God, You lift up my head. David was in trouble at this time. He was running for his life. Panicsville. Dread. And if God hadn't worked, Absalom very well could have killed David. He had him outnumbered. He had him in a bad spot there for a while. David was a man of war. He was used to battling. He was used to fighting. And the thing that he did was what? How'd he handle it? Huh? He's constantly talking about God. And you see, this psalm is a prophecy. The spirit of prophecy was on David. Even in the midst of the danger, he was able to prophesy. His mind was on God. Of all the people in the world, they should have been trusting in the army. It was David. He was a man of war, but he never trusted in his army. He's strong. He said, a bow of bronze is broken by my arms. That's not easy. He was powerful, but he never trusted in his strength. He trusted in God. And people, we're coming into battle. This is a David time. I don't want to go into all the types tonight, why this is a David time. But we're coming now into a David time. We're coming into a time of war. The Solomon time of peace and glory is down the trail. Before you can have a Solomon time, you must have a David time. And David, God was with him. Everywhere he went, he won. He was victorious. He was such a man of war that God said, you've got so much blood on your hands, you can't build the temple. We just war all his life. But you know that when God laid out the boundaries of the land of promise, and we think of the land of promise, well, you can't see it from there, it's too small, but we think of the land of promise going from the Mediterranean Sea to the Jordan. Now, what you see in the paper today, where they keep talking about the West Bank, the West Bank, the West Bank, what the Arabs are trying to do is, all right, picture now. Israel's a tiny land. All right, here's the Mediterranean Sea over here. Maybe you didn't know what they're talking about. Why? The Jews are upset. All right, you've got over here the Mediterranean Sea like this, and Egypt is down here. And right here is the Dead Sea, and then the Jordan goes up like this to the Sea of Galilee. Jerusalem is about in here. Now this area right here, this is the West Bank. This is the West Bank right here. Now Israel, across here, across going from the Jordan to the Mediterranean by jet is about 3 minutes. That's how small Israel is. Across the waste of Israel is about 3 minutes by jet. And the Arabs and the United States pushing this, are trying to settle, they're trying to make an independent Arab state in here on the West Bank. Well, this would make Israel indefensible. Militarily, it would be indefensible. Don't you see what the Arabs are up to is to drive them into the sea? And the United States is supporting them. So what Shamir and the other hardliners are doing is they're filling up this area here with the refugees from Russia. See? to give them a buffer, because then that gives them the Jordan, which is a natural military line of defense, right? When we were there, a lot of this area is barbed wire, and probably some of it is mined. Well, they're settling that. That's land. But see, the Arabs have in mind to drive the Jews into the Mediterranean. And the United States is saying, yeah, I'll give them land for peace. This is the land they're talking about. And the Golan up here, which you can mount a cannon and shell the whole land. And see, the American people are ignorant of that. They think, well, you know, what's going on? What's the big deal? The big deal is that Israel doesn't have enough land. And this is very important. Well, over here, this is the Arabian Desert in here. That's a lot of land. And then here, right in here, about in here, is the Persian Gulf. And then up from here, and going over like that, is the Euphrates River. How am I doing, Bill? Bill knows all this stuff. Now, when God, in Joshua, the book of Joshua, when God laid out the land, he said from the Lebanon, which is up here, Lebanon, to the Negev, which is down here, the desert, and then from the Great Sea, the Mediterranean, to the Euphrates. It was not. See, we think of the Holy Land as being between the Jordan River and the Mediterranean, but if you look in Joshua 1 verse 4, you'll find out that it goes, that it's all this area here, all the way over to the Euphrates. Iraq is right about in here. That's ancient Babylon. That's where Babylon was. So this whole land, and guess who was the only king to conquer that whole area? David. Never before and never since have the Jews been able to hold the land that was given to them. You read Joshua 1:4. Every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon. And this Lebanon down to the, what they call it, the River of Egypt, which is down in Negev or something like that. And from the Mediterranean to the Euphrates, the great river. That's a great river, whatever they call it. The only one who ever got that land was David. And to get it, he fought. And whenever he fought, God was with him, and he gained the victory in every battle. He made all the tribes around there, brought them into subjection, posted garrisons, made forts there, and kept them paying money, paying duty each year. They had to pay gold into the treasury in Jerusalem. He conquered the whole area. Everybody paid tribute money to David. Solomon enjoyed it and then lost it because he was not a man of war. He had 700 wives and 300 concubines. And as far as the Bible tells, not one of those wives was from Israel. Every one of them was from the heathen tribes. The first wife he married was whom, do you know? Pharaoh's daughter. He didn't marry a nice Jewish girl. He married Pharaoh's daughter and built a palace for her. And from then on, he took women from the Edomites, every place you can imagine, till he had all these wives, all burning incense to strange gods. And when he got old and foolish, he built churches for Chemosh and all the other heathen gods, and God spoke to him. And he said, I'm going to leave this with you for David's sake. Not for your sake, but for David's sake. But afterward, I'm going to tear away all these kingdoms except one. I'm going to leave Judah to your son as to Rehoboam for David's sake. Never once for Solomon's sake. Everything that Solomon gained was won by a man of war. Now, we're coming now, Paul, we're in Psalms 3, talking about David and his battles when he fled from Absalom. And that when you go to serve the Lord, the time that we're in is a time when the enemy is in control. The church has never been able to take its inheritance. And so the battle starts now. And so God is giving us songs of war, songs of war, a heart to fight. So every one of these songs has meaning to us. How many are they that rise up against me? But you, Lord, you're a shield for me. David won. He was a winner. He was a winner. Hallelujah. And Jesus is called, even to this day, the Son of David. You lift up my head. All my problems and my battles, Lord, you lift up my head. To the Lord, I cry aloud. To the Lord, I cry aloud. Now, there's something in the spirit realm. When people get bound, they cannot cry aloud. I've seen that so many times. There's something, you say, well, what? God isn't deaf. I know God isn't deaf. But there's something about noise that does something in the spirit realm. You can sit in church and they say, it's quiet and reverent. Not where I've been, it isn't. And the organ's playing softly and everything's quiet and people are sitting there and I'm looking out the window wishing it was over. Because it's the quietness of spiritual death. There's no difference between a church service and a funeral. Everybody's sitting there bound by Satan. Listen, when I die, I tell you what I want, Stan, you're there. War songs. I don't want anybody moping around, playing some soft thing, and everybody coming in there half frozen because of the spirit of death. The spirit of death causes oppression, and it surrounds the casket, and everybody's reverent. They're not reverent, they're petrified in the presence of this great angel. Well, it doesn't do anything good for the dead person to have everybody around there with a long face. That doesn't accomplish one blessed thing except depress everybody out of their mind so that the relatives are worse off than they ordinarily would be. So when I die, I'm telling you right now, I want noise and people shouting to the Lord and the kids dancing in the aisle. Shout! I cry unto the Lord. Softly, so people would know I was in church. It was very reverent. Not God's warriors. To the Lord I cry aloud. When you feel yourself oppressed, cry aloud. You say, well, it's the relatives are in the house. Well, go in your bedroom and shut the door and say, Lord, get this thing off my back. I can't breathe. Suffocating me. Yeah, it's the truth. There's something about noise. I don't know what it is. I guess there's a relationship between the physical and the material realm. And the demons try to keep everything quiet, quiet, quiet. Except, of course, where they're doing rock and roll or something. But wherever people are worshiping God, it's quiet, saintly, it's reverent. Shh, shh. Not where I am. Mm-mm. It doesn't work in war. I cried to the Lord. I cried out. He wasn't running around with Joab. What do you think we'll do, Joab? We'll set an ambush for him. We'll do that. Here's David, supposed to be fleeing from Absalom. What's he doing? Prophesying. Praise the Lord. Yeah, that's we should be doing that all day long. All day long. Not just in church. And he answers me. He answers me. When you cry aloud, he will answer you. You may not feel like there's any answer. You can't feel God's presence. You don't have any faith that anything's going to happen. It just seems like a waste of time. Try it and see. Cry aloud when you have problems. Say, Lord, help me. I'm in a mess here. When it seems impossible. See what happened. What is God's holy hill? Huh? Zion. Zion. What do we know about Zion? What do we know about Zion? Right. What was it in relationship to Jerusalem? True. It was a city of David. But what was it in with respect to Jerusalem? Judy? Well, it was lost. They say that it was kind of in the southeast portion, but they're not agreed on that. The temple was in the northeast, but the scholars aren't agreed. It was a suburb. It was inside the city. It was a suburb. But it was the place from which it was easiest to defend the hill, the mountain of Jerusalem. And when Joab captured Jerusalem from the Jebusites, it was defended at this place. And so Joab went up through an aqueduct, and he captured it, and David built it up then and made a fortress out of it, and that's where he brought the ark. So wherever you see the hill, or your holy hill, or Zion, you're talking about war. You're talking about this place where the ark is, and that David made it a special place of war. Zion, a suburb within the larger area of Jerusalem that was the place where Jerusalem was defended, and it was a place of war. And David referred to it constantly because we're coming into a David time now. He answers me from his holy hill. Then what does he say? Selah. Meditate on that. I cried aloud to God, and this guy Absalom's after me, my son, and I feel bad about it. I don't want to kill him, and if I don't, he's going to kill me. What in the world am I going to do? He was in a bad way. I cried aloud unto God, and he heard me out of his holy hill. Think about it. Think about it. I lie down and sleep. How are you sleeping at night? How are you sleeping at night? Huh? Do you know the Bible said it is vain to stay up late, burn the candle at both ends? What does it say about God's beloved? He gives you sleep. He gives his beloved sleep. He says, vain for you. Rise up early and work late. We have a work ethic. I do. I got it from my New England parentage. A boy, I find if I work too hard, I don't sleep. Did you ever find that's true? My mind goes all night long. And God says, I'm not looking for you to do this sort of thing. He gives his beloved, how are you sleeping? Anybody in here tormented at night? Are you tormented by spirits? You are. We'll pray about that tonight. God doesn't want you tormented, and he doesn't want you afraid at night. You go to bed worrying, financial worries, worries about what's going to happen later, dread the coming of morning. When it's morning, then you wish it was night again, so you go back to bed. You ever been there? Anxiety and fear. God wants to, if you're like that tonight, maybe we'll have prayer. God wants you to lay down and sleep. Here's David who's got his, in danger of his life. He said, I lie down and sleep. Praise the Lord. That's your inheritance. If you're not sleeping well at night, we need to pray about it. That's your inheritance in the Lord is to sleep soundly all night long. You can't do a good job if you don't. It's your inheritance to sleep. Sometimes it's a battle. Sometimes it doesn't come easy. But at least if you know that it's God's will in the Word, it'll give you faith to press into it. And don't settle for anything less than a good night's sleep. God wants you to sleep well and soundly without fear. Praise the Lord. Now, I would recommend highly against watching television. That is not a good way to relax. Go to bed early, especially if you get up early. There's nothing wrong with going to bed at 7 o'clock. There is no law against it. There is no law against going to bed at 7 o'clock at night when it gets dark? Huh? No law against it. Go to bed early. Sleep. You need it. David says, I lie down and sleep. I wake again because the Lord sustains me. I wake again because the Lord sustains me. Now, what I'd like to say about that is this. Don't take anything for granted. You know, we say, well, I take it for granted I'm going to wake up in the morning. Don't take anything for granted. One of the worst things we do in life is we take things for granted. We figure, well, this will work. I know this will work, so there's no problem here. Don't take anything for granted. Just stay right with it. Pray about everything. When you go to bed at night, pray that God will wake you up. Pray that God will give you a good sleep and will wake you up at the time you're supposed to wake up. Don't take anything for granted. As soon as your eyes open in the morning, begin to pray about everything, everything you can think of. Just keep it up. Don't take anything for granted. You say, I woke up because I was rested. No, I wake again because the Lord sustained me. Until our whole life is in Jesus. Until our whole life is in Jesus. Until everything that we do is in Jesus. Now, what am I talking about? War. War. Watching constantly in prayer so that the enemy doesn't get a chance to get in anywhere. Larry's moving. That needs prayer. You can move safely 9/10 of the way, and you get careless and foolish and think I've got it made, and your trailer tips over. That's right. You don't leave anything for granted. There's nothing you can do of yourself. Jesus said, of my own self, I can do nothing. Sounds like an exaggeration. Well, surely there's something that you can do. I know when I was up at Dennis's, I was going to play on the piano a little and show off at the end of the service. I couldn't play for Sour Beans. I couldn't even remember the songs we did here. I couldn't remember anything. I thought, well, sirs, you're right. You know, you're just going to do it. You know, you think you can do it. You can't do it. Everything. I need the Lord's anointing to play the piano. You need the Lord's anointing in everything that you do to get home safely. I awaken not because I was rested, because the Lord sustained me. I awaken because the Lord sustained me. Well, there's things I can do. I can drive downtown. No. We're in a war. And the enemy is watching you all the time to see if your mind is drifting. You're thinking thoughts you shouldn't be doing, or saying things you shouldn't be doing, or doing things you shouldn't be doing. I awake. I get downtown safely because the Lord sustained me. I went in and brought my groceries because the Lord sustained me. I got out again to the car with my groceries because the Lord sustained me. And I got home again because the Lord sustained me. I awaken. Because the Lord sustained me. I will not fear the tens of thousands drawn up against me on every side. I will not fear. Now, there's a fear. I read in one book about a fellow that was fighting fear, and he said he put pressure on his knees. That was the expression that he used. He was afraid of what he was doing and afraid of where he was going. And he said, I just put pressure on my knees. And I kept going. Some people meet fear by exhaling. It keeps you from getting short of breath. People, there's times in this spiritual war when you have to go forward when you're scared to death. And whether you want to call it pressure on your knees or what, you just get up whatever you got and you just keep going. And you're sick at your stomach, you've got the dreads, and your mouth is dry, and you just keep going. Just keep going. You say, I will not fear. And fear comes against you like a thing you can feel. I will not fear. I refuse to fear. I will simply not fear. If you don't think that that takes faith in the Lord, you haven't ever tried it. It takes faith. Now, thanks be to God, most of our life is not spent with the dreads. But sometimes they come. And it may be with a sick child. Or it may be with bad news. Or it may be with a lawsuit. Or it may be with something else that's hovering over us. In our life, which was so nice and so smooth, and the sun shone so brightly in the morning, and all of a sudden it's just darkness on every side. There's just no way out. And the temptation, you would think in a time like that you would pray. It's the hardest thing in the world to pray when you're that frightened. You'll see what I mean when it comes to you. It's very difficult. You don't want to exert yourself. You just want to kind of hide and just hope for better news. Sometimes you have to keep going forward. Sometimes you have to make decisions that are very difficult. Decisions that are very difficult that involve loved ones. What you have to do is just stand up straight and do it. And refuse to allow fear to master you. I will not fear. And people in the world do that. They lay pressure on their knees so that they don't tremble, and they force themselves to do what is right when they're frozen with fear. But we've got something better than that. What is it? We have the knowledge that the Lord is with us. And so we're not whistling in the dark. We're not just with a show of bravery. We are showing faith in God and confidence in His Word. And even though it takes a lot of courage, we exert that courage. But in our hearts and minds, we know we're not whistling in the dark, that if we do this, God is going to be with us and He is going to deliver us. Now, fearful times are coming. You can imagine what it would be like if you were working. For example, let's say you're working away from home and you had a babysitter with the kids. Your wife was somewhere, you're someplace else, and there's a babysitter with the kids. Maybe you're a 30-minute drive from home, and there's a bad earthquake, a real shaker, 8.5 on the Richter scale. The mains are broken. Water's running out in the street. They can't put out the fires. Buildings have crashed. The mobs that have been preparing for this begin to go out in a systematic way to loot, because that's what they're waiting for. To take over various things. The police can't begin to handle the hospital, and you can't get home. And your children are there. And your husband or wife is someplace else. How many know these things happen to people? How many know these things happen to people? Now, the Philippines just had a terrible thing, didn't they, with that Mount Pinatubo. And all that happened there was people like that, people separated from their families, people running through earthquakes, looking under the rubble that has happened at different places of the world. Did you see my little girl? Did you see my little boy? Now, things like that happen to people. And that's what these psalms are for. So that when they do, you don't just stand and scream in a panic, lay on the ground and kick your feet or do something. You just straighten up and you say, Lord God, you've kept me this far. You know where my loved ones are. If they're dead, they're with you. They're safe. If it's your will that we'll be reunited, we'll be reunited. And you just buck up, you know, dry mouth and all, nausea and all, the dread, and you just go forward. And pretty soon you begin to feel the Lord saying, it's okay. It's all going to be all right. And as soon as you feel that, your courage comes back and you're okay. Remember that for the day of trouble. I will not fear, though 10,000s drawn up against me on every side. Arise, O Lord. Arise, O Lord. Deliver me, O my God. Arise, O Lord. Rise up. We're not looking for inner strength. We're looking for the strength that is ample, that is from above, that is from God. Deliver me, O my God. Strike all my enemies on the jaw. It makes me think of Smith Wigglesworth. Now, the Bible says that we're not to rail against evil dignitaries. We're not to be cursing, you know, or saying evil things about the principalities and powers. But there is a way that God will honor that we can fight back against evil spirits. Smith Wigglesworth is dead now, but he was a plumber from England, had a great gift of faith, a tremendous gift of faith that usually worked out in healing. And he'd take the people, and people would come up to him, you know, that were crippled or had maybe palsy or some other terrible human thing. He wanted to have compassion on them. And Smith Wigglesworth would grab them. And he would say, why did you let that dirty devil get a hold of you? I mean, no sympathy. And he would shake them and he would rebuke the thing and come against it. You'll leave now. And that's it. Now get out and run down the aisle. You know, and here's some lady about 70 years old who's been in a wheelchair. Get up and run down the aisle. Well, you and I would try that. It wouldn't work. But he had a gift and it worked. And the people that obeyed him found that the mighty power of God struck them and they could run. But his attitude towards Satan was interesting. And I think the Lord spoke to me a couple of months ago and he said, fight back. And he wasn't talking about people either. But he was talking about oppression and accusations and other things filling my mind. And I was bearing up under it and just kind of chewing it to death. And I was on my prayer walk, and it seemed like the Lord spoke to me, and he said, fight back. And I rose up within myself. I didn't feel much like it, but I rose up within myself, and I began to push against these things. And I said, I'm not going to put up with this. I am not going to put up with this. I am going to fight back. I'm walking in God. I know that I'm in God. I know that my sins have been confessed and repented of. I know that my heart is right and I'm washed in the blood, and I am not going to put up with this. And lifted. Lifted. Fight back. Don't take fear laying down. Don't take some of the things that come. Accusations. I can't make it. Discouragement. You know, everybody in the church is making it but me. I can't make it. Don't take it lying down. Fight back. Say, I can make it. I can do it. I'm going to put force on my knees. I'm going to take God's word. I'm going to stand up. And he says, deliver me, my God. Strike my enemies on the jaw. See, first he is saying, be a shield. Now he's saying, hit them, Lord. Hit them. Hit them. Strike my enemies on the jaw. Break the teeth of the wicked. Oh, God, rise up. Satan's having a field day in my life. I'm not going to put up with this thing. God, smite. Be my horn of power. Smite. I'm not going to take this, Lord. I'm living in you, and you know it. Lord, smite them. Burn them. Oh, I prayed that many a time. Lord, burn them. Put your fire on them. Jab them. Get them away from me. Make them miserable that come near me. Do you ever do that? From the Lord comes deliverance. From the Lord comes deliverance. We don't have to deliver ourselves. From the Lord comes deliverance. We don't have to deliver ourselves. We don't have to lead the overcoming life by ourselves. People get discouraged. I can't make it. Man, I've got so many sins in my life, I can't make it. From the Lord comes deliverance. Hallelujah. Jesus is our deliverer. You know, Jesus does a lot more than forgive us. He does a lot more than forgive us. He's our Redeemer. That's one of the messages of this church. I was thinking about that. I've been redoing my book, Revelation 21 and 22, and I got to thinking about the people in the lake of fire. Starts off with the timid. Then it goes into the sorcerers. Then it goes into the adulterers. It goes into the liars. It goes into these other things. And I thought, yeah, but the average teaching is that, but if we accept Jesus, we have no danger of the lake of fire. The Bible doesn't teach that. The Bible doesn't teach that. It doesn't teach that Jesus came so we don't have any danger of the lake of fire. The lake of fire has authority over all liars, whether they accept Christ or not. The lake of fire has authority over all sorcerers, has authority over all adulterers, over all the timid. They belong in the lake of fire, and the lake of fire knows that, and it has authority over them. And Jesus never came to waive that authority. He never came to invalidate that authority. That authority remains. Jesus came to do something else. What is it? He came to deliver us from timidity. Not to make it so that we can be timid and escape the lake of fire. That concept, that change of thought about what Jesus came to do is one of the basic messages of this church, and it's one of the basic messages of the kingdom of God. This change of thinking, and Deborah and Rebecca are taking notes, the difference in what Jesus came to do, he did not come and say to us, it's okay, you can lie and go into paradise, it's all right. I've come to save you. That's not what salvation means. You can be a liar. All these things that people are going into the lake of fire for, you can do these if you call upon my name. That's how the church understands Jesus. And it's not right. That is not what Jesus is. The world has got a complete misunderstanding of salvation, of what Jesus is. And we have a responsibility with the knowledge that we have in this church to do something about it. And we are doing something about it. We got a letter from Roberta Kellum today. Praise the Lord. And it's wonderful. The kingdom of God and what's happening. And the ministry that's going on there. And the way the people are receiving it. The kingdom, the righteousness that God is requiring. Jesus didn't come. So you say, yeah, I'm timid and I'm all these things, but good old Jesus, I won't be in the lake of fire. That's a misunderstanding. That is not how Christianity works. Jesus came as a man of war. He came as the son of David. He came to his church so that through his power, he might break the power of Satan. Not forgive the power of Satan, but break the power of Satan. And the church has never been able to rise to that. Why, I don't know. There's something about the nature of mankind that Jesus had to go back in the book of Acts and begin to start with man, pour out his spirit. He knew they would lose it. He knew he had, and I've been studying, Audrey and I have been studying history quite a bit. When you see the way Christianity worked in Europe, see the way Christianity worked in Scandinavia and in England, and you realize how crude it was, yet it was Christianity, and it was fought by those that believed in the Norse gods, particularly the Danes coming from Iceland, coming from Norway, coming from Denmark, coming from the north, determined to crush this new religion, and yet in the religion of Christianity, there is so little that we would recognize. It was Catholic. It consisted of bishops that were, and then the little churches they had around the bishop saw on some kind of basic understanding that Jesus was God's son, but so little. And I'm talking about 800, 900 AD. And from that time to this, God has brought the Christian church by the time of Martin Luther, it had gotten almost complete darkness, but that darkness had been through what is called the Dark Ages, which is around 400 AD to about 1000 AD. And since that time, God has actually brought us into so much back to the apostolic days, back to holiness, the second coming of the Lord, and then Pentecost, speaking in tongues, the body of Christ, and all these things. We can't imagine how different what we have today is different from what they had 800, 900 AD. And yet they were Christians. And why did God have to bring this church through such a long, torturous route? They had no way of breaking the power of the devil. They didn't even know it was possible. And even to this day, throughout the whole church world, the idea is that Jesus came to forgive the sins of the world. And it's not what he came to do at all. He came to break the yoke of the devil. He came as the son of David, as a man of war. And that's why God is moving us forward. This war music, the reason people are rebelling against it, not in this church they're not, but in other churches, the brethren tell me there are people that are taking exception to it. They don't want it. Let me tell you, it is a move past Pentecost. It is a move of God. This world music is an actual movement of God. I mean, you see in the history of Israel that when they left Mount Sinai, which represents the Holy Spirit, the baptism with the Holy Spirit is Mount Sinai. And then immediately after they left Sinai, God gave the directions for the tabernacle of the congregation. So we would expect from Pentecost, the next thing after would be an awareness of the body of Christ. And that's exactly what happened. In 1950, 1960, they begin to talk about the body of Christ. We never heard that before. You can go back in church history. You won't find any talk about the body of Christ. They talked about the church universal, but they never used the expression of the body of Christ. That's new. But after the tabernacle was built, then God, as soon as he got the tabernacle built, God began to take the Israelites, who were a mob up to this time, and he began to give them instructions as to how they should camp around the tabernacle. He began to organize them for war. And he said, when you sound the trumpet, then Moses and the priests will go out in front with Judah praising the Lord. And then this tribe will move. And then will come the things of the tabernacle. And then the other tribe will move. And then the rear guard under the standard of Benjamin will move. That had never been true before. It's never been true in the church before. We don't even understand. But God is bringing us in this war. Is what God is saying is beginning, and hell knows it. And we're going to have to learn how to fight. And it's going to be these battles, this constant fear and learning, the psalms of war. How are they increased that come against me? But thou, O Lord, art a shield unto me, my glory and the lifter of my head, little by little, line upon line. And God is organizing us. One of the things that we're learning is discipline. Discipline. And so the Lord is beginning to talk to us about self-will. We cannot say anymore. There's no more place for exalted ministry. It's war, war, and God leading the elders. Hallelujah. The day of, pastor this and evangelist that. It's history. It won't serve anymore. It is God's time. He's getting ready to show what salvation is all about. It is not an excuse so that ungodly people can escape hell. It is the deliverance from the things that bring us into the lake of fire. Jesus came to deliver us from witchcraft, to deliver us from adultery, because the laws that govern the lake of fire are not changed by accepting Christ. They are not changed. As long as we lie, we are not safe near that lake. It reaches out because it has control over all liars. Believe me, that never changes. It has charge over all the timid. As long as there's timidity in you and you come near that lake, there's a power, there's authority, and that lake is saying, this is mine. As long as you have adultery and lust and perversion, the Bible groups all the things that are going on today under one word in the lake of fire. Do you know what it is? Abominations. Child molestation would come under that. It's an abomination. Homosexuality, lesbianism, perversion, cannibalism come under that heading. Abominations. And everyone who works in abomination, when you come near that lake of fire, let me tell you, there's a lake that burns with a blue flame. It's a lake that burns with fire and sulfur, and the acrid smell of sulfur comes off it. And it's in the interior of the earth. And it claims every adulterer. It claims everyone who works in abomination. It has authority over them. And God's gospel is that God has come to deliver us so that the lake has no more authority. You see this, a whole of the psalm, we're about through it, in Revelation chapter 2. Hey? Okay, Revelation chapter 2. Okay. Verse 11. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He who overcomes will not be hurt by the second death. It doesn't say he who accepts Jesus will not be hurt by the second death. It says he who overcomes. What do you overcome? The things that you go into the lake of fire for, which is in Revelation 21, verse 8. Timidity, lying, abominations, witchcraft. And until you overcome, it's not enough to accept Christ. You have to overcome, because there's certain things that God doesn't mess with. He doesn't mess with the law of sowing and reaping. It's a law that God installed. And there's another law that God says, the soul that sins, it shall die. God has never changed that law. In Jesus, he has given us a way to suspend that law until we have a chance to change, to repent. God never changes his laws. And you'll see again in Revelation chapter 20. Chapter 20 of the book of Revelation in verse, what is it, 5? All right, 6. Blessed and holy are those who have part in the first resurrection. The second death has no authority over them. Why? Because they are blessed and holy. Now, God knows his church. He knows where they are, in heaven and upon the earth. And I'm telling you that the whole creation is waiting for God to raise up an army that can go and break this sin so that the whole church can be set free, and anyone among the nations who will listen to it can set free, be set free, not from the lake of fire, but from the thing that brings you into the lake of fire. Do you see that? That's what it means in the Bible by when you see these things come to pass, lift up your heads, for your redemption draws near. When you see the earthquakes and the war and the famines, Jesus said, lift up your heads, for your redemption draws near. And in 1 Peter, it speaks of the Christian. It says, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. That salvation is here. You must study history if you would appreciate what God has given us today. The church has never been at this place before. It's never had the understanding before. And I tell you, I believe the Lord Jesus has been sitting at the right hand of God, is standing up. And the war songs are coming down from Zion in heaven. They're not being composed by men. They're being composed through men. Who teaches my hands to war. Never had that. You should hear the songs we sang in Bible school in the late 40s were sappy. Sappy compared to what's coming forth now on the Jericho Road, just Jesus and you and all this stuff. In those days, they were anointed. Today, they sound like kindergarten stuff. Who teaches my hands to war? Who teaches my hands to war? Why? Because it's time to release the creation from the grip of the devil so they don't all end up in the lake of fire. And that's your calling and that's mine. David said, from the Lord comes deliverance. May your blessing be on your people. Every generation has to serve God according to the revelation given. You can't go back and be an old Baptist or an old Pentecost or anything, because God will not bless it. The anointing has gone off there. The priesthood is moving on. And the anointing is here, and it's here for war. And yes, you're going to have 10,000 enemies round about you. And you can't retreat back into the old church ways of doing things. And it isn't going to be any good to go to a church where there's 3 points and a conclusion. We, all of us, are stuck in it whether we like it or not. We've got to go forward in the war and obey God and take our knacks. It's a David time, and we're going to win in Jesus because he is leading us. Amen. We're in a dispensation of war. It's changing. The ark is here. Zion is here. Hallelujah. If any of these things are true, let's stand. Is there anyone here?